Okay. Right. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, friends and members of the Royal Society of Chemistry Belgian section, to our presentation this evening, which is going to be given by one of our long-standing members, Albert Dijkstra from Ghent. I was going to give you a detailed summary of his curriculum vitae, but in fact, as you will see from Albert's presentation, that is on the second slide, so I don't need to do that at the moment. I will just remind you that he actually did his PhD in Ghent, not in Ghent, in Leiden, and then worked for ICI in the UK, the Netherlands, and eventually in Belgium, and then ended up as Director of Research and Development at the Van der Mortel Group in Belgium from 78 to 97. And since then, he's been acting very active as a scientific consultant and a reviewer in the field of edible oil processing. We're very grateful for him to have offered to give us this presentation, and we're looking forward to hearing you. When I used to give teaching in biochemistry, the question of fats didn't appeal as a great subject to teach, but I have to say that when you think about the importance of biochemistry and the role of the hydrophobic effect in producing biochemical effects, you can see how important it is to have molecules that have non-water soluble components. So can I ask you, Albert, to take over from here, and we look forward to your presentation, and we'll have a chance to have discussions and questions afterwards. Looking forward to the talk. Thank you very much. Albert, over to you.
Okay, thank you, Bob, for this introduction. I will talk about edible oils and start at a very early stage and go to through the ages. As Bob has already mentioned, I'm a gas kineticist by training. So I had training in research while in Leiden and while starting with ICI. Here I had training on working in a plant, training as running projects. So I was well prepared to start with Van der Mortel as their R&D director. And I did this with great fun. But of course, I had no idea about what edible oils and fats were like. Because as Bob said, you just learned a bit about it and that was it. So let's go a long way back. What did we eat in the way of fats in the past? Well, if you hunt and or you collect nuts, then these nuts contain fat as to feed the plants that have to grow out of the nut. And if you then eat the nuts, you get the fat. And the same is when you eat an animal that is fat. But now I am a bit confused because somebody did something to my screen and I can't go back to the text.
You need to get the picture up on the screen again.
Yes, I didn't touch anything.
Well,
so you want that I can upload your presentation if you want.
Well, I read a book about olive oil, and there they proudly present an olive oil mill that has been restored in southern Turkey, and they claim this olive oil to be we're back.
Yeah, but you have to tell me when you want to change the slide, please.
If you just ask us, we'll change the slide for you.
I ask for the next one. Not yet. Okay. But that oil mill is quite a complicated effort. And I think that the early animal fat production was just by rendering. Now, I don't know whether you know what rendering is. You take a fatty animal, cut it up in pieces and start boiling it in water. And then the fat oozes out of the tissue and you are left with lean meat and free fat. I lived in southern France for a couple of years, and that is duck country. So they breed ducks, feed them so that they get fat, and then they slaughter them and start preparing foie gras and the magret de canard and confit de canard. Now, duck fat has the advantage that it doesn't crack when it cools down. So it is an excellent way of not only producing fat, but also of preserving meat. Now you put the defatted pieces of meat in a jar, pour the fat over it, and you can keep it for months. Okay, that was the supply was not efficient, so people started farming, they grew olives and started oil milling. Sesame seed was good because it has a fairly high oil content. And nowadays, palm oil and soybean oil and rapeseed, sunflower and so forth are very much bigger than all the others together. People also had milk, and they could make cream out of it by letting it stand. Then they could whip it up and make butter. And in countries that with high ambient temperature, the butter would melt and could not be used as such. So they dehydrated it by melting it and separating the two layers. And they got ghee, which is now replaced by vanaspati. And the butter is replaced by margarine because there are so many more of us. Animal fats have always been used, but fish oil and whale oil were stabilized by hydrogenation. This is of the past, but pigs give you lard. And it is interesting to see that countries like Germany, Austria, that are very much pig-oriented, still use shortening rather than margarine in cooking. Whereas countries that use are more butter-oriented, like the United Kingdom, they use margarine. May I have the next one? I see the control again. Yeah?
Can you go by yourself?
It works. Yeah, okay, fair enough. I can go on myself. Here, you are a chemicals group. So this are the structure of a triglyceride. You have here the central backbone of the glycerol. And there are 1, 2, 3 fatty acid groups, esterified to the 3 hydroxyl groups. This 2 shouldn't be there. It is not on the slides we tried to get on screen before, but okay. So I apologize for this mistake. It's rather basic. And so these are the materials we talk about. But we have here these fatty acids. And the fatty acids, they come from nature. And they're always straight chain carboxylic acids. And the number of carbon atoms is practically always even because they are synthesized by bits of 2. The double bonds have cis configuration, and as shown here. And this, in fact, is oleic acid. And if there is are 2 double bonds, they're always separated by a methylene group. And because this is bisallylic, that makes this molecule rather prone to oxidation. Then there are minor fatty acids that contain all kind of funny groups that we don't have to worry about. but we now come to Meneer Chevreul. He published a book in 1823 about edible oils and fats. And in fact, he was the first lipid chemist. On his 100th birthday, the book was reprinted because it was still not out of date. He was an excellent experimentalist, and he measured all kinds of things you could lay his hands on. So he had the fatty acid composition, more or less, of a prisoner who was tortured to death. He felt that cholesterol was also fatty, but discovered that it was not a normal triglyceride fat. He was a very good experimentalist, and so he developed recrystallization to purify organic compounds until they had a constant melting point, and then he called it the pure compound. He was a great man. Oils and fats have been used for a long time. I have a forefather, great-great-grandfather, who in the Netherlands owned windmills and traded cakes and oil. Well, what was this? He bought linseed and crushed it and made linseed oil. And he had another windmill in which he ground pigments and he mixed the pigments with the linseed oil, and he sold paint, and he sold the cake residue of the oil manufacturer to farmers in the neighborhood as cattle feed. So it's an old subject. And this is shown by the analytical methods. Well, first of all, something which any analyst will be told not to do at all nowadays, Chevreul always tasted his products and described how they tasted. And he survived. He was 102 when he died. But then there were quantifying means to quantify the properties of the fats under investigation. So there's a saponification value. How much caustic do you need to saponify some fat? That gives you a measure of the average molecular mass of the triglycerides. You can measure how acid they are. That tells you how much caustic you need during neutralization of the fat. And so there are many other values that have been used for centuries. Now, here. There are also instrumental methods. So there is the Loviband color measurement. A totally useless way of measuring color because it has been geared towards beer, and it uses tinted glasses to compare colors. The colors you get are not additive, so but it is in specifications, and so yes, people go on measuring oil as if it were beer. You have gas liquid chromatography that is used a lot to determine the fatty acid composition of edible oils and fats. And if you go to a bit higher temperature, you can also determine the number. You can get a separation according to the total number of carbon atoms in a triglyceride. At a low temperature, you can use the first phase HPLC that tells you how much what the carbon number minus the double bonds is. Time domain NMR is used for the solid fat content, which for practical purposes is quite important. So oils and fats contain different triglycerides. I showed you the structure with R1, R2, and R3. But even two fatty acids give you already eight different isomers, triglyceride isomers. So when you have more fatty acids, then you get an enormous number of different triglycerides in an edible oil as we know it. That is why they hardly ever have a sharp melting point. They have a melting range. And if you reshuffle the fatty acids over the glycerol molecules, these properties change. For instance, cocoa butter has a melting point of, say, 37 degrees C. But it has a high content of saturated fatty acids. If you reshuffle, you get a lot of trisaturated fatty acids, and the melting point is raised to close to 80, I would guess. The fatty acids, of course, that are in a certain triglyceride affect the properties of the physical properties of that fat. And there are some general rules for this. How much do we produce? Well, has grown quite steeply. At the moment, statistics tell us that we produce more than 200 million tons of edible oils and fats per annum. But these figures should be a bit interpreted, because they are limited to fats that are produced as such. Yeah? So the milk fat that is produced, that's present in milk and in cream and in ice cream and cheese and so forth, is not counted because it's not a fat. They count the butter because that is a fatty product. And the same is fat in meat you eat is not counted, included in the production figures, because it is not produced as lard, pig's fat, or tallow, beef fat. Then the number of fats they look at is limited, walnut and hazelnut oil, quite important, but they are not. Some fats are produced as such, but not included. And some fats are not taken into account at all. Breast milk is fairly fat. They don't count this as being consumed. People eat about 1 kilogram of fat per annum from eggs. This is generally not known by diet. Why does it grow? Excuse me. Well, there are more and more people. They are getting more affluent. And there are other applications than just food. Now, the 45 degrees kilogram per annum in the US includes a fair amount of oleochemistry and biodiesel. This is not just consumed. And in India, people will have their own pig running around and eating it without this fat entering the statistics. So it is a charged picture. Now I must go. Which fats are imported? Well, palm oil is by now the most important edible oil produced. Formerly, this was soybean oil. But palm oil has a great advantage that it has a very high productivity per acreage. It's mainly produced in Indonesia and Malaysia, which means that the palm kernel oil, which is a co-product, is also produced in these countries. So this is the 207 from the statistics, and that is a mere 5% of what we produce per annum on annual mineral oil production. So just to put biodiesel a bit in perspective. We don't produce any whale oil anymore. Fish oil we don't hydrogenate anymore because we need it in fish farming. So the growth is mainly from vegetable oil. At the moment, it varies, but you can perhaps you get 3 to 5 tons of oil per annum per hectare. But there have been experimental plots where this has been much higher yield has been achieved. Soybean oil, yeah, is a big product. Not because people want soybean oil, but because they want the meal. The meal goes into pig feed, chicken feed, and so forth. And that is the main reason for the soybean expansion. And rapeseed is a new European crop, Canadian, and also in China. Now, what will we eat in future? Algal oils or insect lipids? Nobody knows. Not interesting to find out. In chemistry, there is the saying, gas or coke, yeah? Why you produce both at the same time? Why do you produce one or the other? And that's the same with co-products like chlorine and caustic soda and so forth. So that means that in the chemical industry, you have balancing processes. You may think of a final chloride plant as a plant to make final chloride. No, it is there to balance the hydrogen chloride market because it can absorb hydrogen chloride by the oxy process, and it can produce hydrogen chloride if you start from molecular chlorine, make ethylene dichloride and crack it to produce final chloride and hydrogen chloride. Now, same balancing supply and demand is also necessary in edible oils and fats, because when you make one part of soybean oil, you get 4 parts of soybean meal. But one part of palm oil is, the palm oil itself has no meal, it's a fruit. And it's only palm kernel that produces some meal. Now, the demand for meal is an independent variable determined by the feed industry. So the feed industry says we need so much meal, and that means so much soybean must be planted. And that means how much soybean oil are being produced. Demand for oil and the availability of the soybean oil determine how much palm oil is being produced. So if you start using more oil, then that stimulates the palm oil production. So governments like the Belgian government, who have high deforestation concerns concerning palm oil, and consumers who look for products don't contain any palm oil haven't a clue what they're talking about. If you want to make more biodiesel, it automatically means that you increase your palm oil production, and you cannot make biodiesel by diminishing palm oil production. And if you start shifting demands and so forth, the prices go haywire anyway. How do you make edible oils and fats? Well, rendering, I mentioned, and early plantation oils, as from our former, he had a windmill, he ground the seeds and put them in a bag, and a wedge, hammer, squeezed the bag, and out came the oil, most of it. Fruit oils are easy, because water and oil don't mix. If you have oil seeds with a low oil content, the best thing to do is solvent extraction. But if you have a high oil content, it is cheaper to pre-press mechanically, and then you get hold of most of the oil present in the seeds, and then you have then the press cake, which you can, in a smaller plant, extract with solvent. And of course, there are specialty fats that are subject to all kinds of regulations. The crude oil composition. Well, main component is triglycerides. If you hydrolyze these monoglycerides, triglycerides, you get partial glycerides, and you get free fatty acids. You have all kinds of things that are soluble in oil or in a solvent and come along and are present in the crude oil. You have, yeah, a lot of dirt. Occasionally you have waxes, which are harmless, but need to be removed for, looks nicer. On the whole, crude oil is a rather foul product. It must be purified, we call it refining. And of course, you also have cold pressed oils, etc. Well, they are less foul, but they are not purified, so their stability is very much in doubt. Just a fashionable product for chemophobics. You start with crude oil. Now, in the crude oil, you have phosphatides, and when they react with water, you get a deposit. So when you want to store that oil or ship it, you must water degum and only be left with the, sorry. Only be left with the non-hydratable phosphatides. If there are not too many of those, you can get rid of them by heating with an acid that decomposes them, and then you absorb the bleaching earth and you can physically refine, which means that the free fatty acids that are present in the oil are stripped out, volatilized, and gone. Sorry. The oldest route is just alkali refining. You take the oil, heat it with alkali, get rid of the soaps and the phosphatides, you bleach and you deodorize. Deodorize are physically refining at both vacuum stripping systems. Acid refining is a more recent process. And enzymatic processes have been introduced to improve the oil yield, because the gums you take out at this stage, the water degumming or acid refining, they entrain a fair amount of oil, and that's a loss. So, degumming gets rid of something. Chemical neutralization gets rid of fatty acids and residual phosphatides. Steam stripping, and you have a bland tasting oil, which is what people want. But it's just an oil. It's not clear whether the physical properties of the oil meets your requirements. So butter was always still the most popular product in France, and they had too little, so margarine was invented. And in fact, this also led to the fractionation process to split beef tallow in a high melting stearin and a moderately high melting olein. But then there was too little beef tallow, so Wilhelm Neumann invented the hydrogenation process. And this has been used for a long time, but now people don't like it anymore. And there is the interesterification process, which is also invented by Wilhelm Neumann. And of course, the cheapest way is blending, but it doesn't always work. So that gives you the fat and oil that you want to make margarine, shortenings. The liquid oils you put in sauces, in mayonnaise, in deep frying oil, that can make deep frying fats, and so forth. Now I come to the health aspects. After the war, you still saw yellow fields with rapeseed at the end of April, early May, and all of a sudden that was banned. Because some rats didn't like it. And in China this was posed a problem because the climate didn't allow many other herbicides to be grown. So they continued with the old-fashioned rabbit. And they're still alive, quite a few of them. So no low erucic acid cultivar was developed, but all this was not really necessary because there is nothing wrong with high erucic acid rapeseed oil anyway. So we shift to saturated fatty acids. Now they are bad, you know, that's all that. They're mentioned on the label. But then if you eat stearic acid, the body immediately dehydrogenates this to form oleic acid, and oleic acid is good. So how bad can stearic acid be? Then people agreed that it was not stearic acid, but palmitic acid was the culprit. But then nobody seemed to realize that people in Malaysia, Indonesia, for them, palm oil is the main oil, and they remain healthy. Same for Lorix, And finally, sorry, ik to, yeah. Yeah. A group of nutritionists came to the conclusion that, well, we have always thought they were bad, but we cannot really prove that they reduce mortality or whatever. So all this, these changes and have been good for nothing. But we have a new culprit, trans isomers. And if you compare the Netherlands, where they eat a lot of margarine, and France, where they eat a lot of butter, mainly, and the margarine contains trans isomers, there is not a clear difference in mortality or life expectancy between the Netherlands and France. So this will change as well, but at the moment it is banned left, right, and center. Cholesterol, well, we all know that it is very bad. And people say, I shouldn't eat too many eggs and so forth. As, oh, this fish is full of cholesterol. On the whole, people synthesize internally in their body far more cholesterol than the diet supplies. And the rate of synthesis is regulated by external supplies. And so if you have margarine with stanols in it, which reduce cholesterol, that's only temporary. Give the body a bit of time and it goes back to producing the right, the increased amount of cholesterol. Now, these stanols, they are undigestible and they act as a lubricant. And they give they cause diarrhea. And this reminds me of a story. Monsieur Raymond van der Beurtelen, my boss, once asked me, what have we got in the way of fat substitutes? And I had to confess that I didn't believe in them and that we didn't have anything. Yeah, he said, but I have seen Procter & Gamble and so forth. And then I said, yes, sir. Olestra is made by Procter & Gamble, a company that is big in detergents and Pampers. And you should look at the Olestra as a sales support for their main products. So, and the evidence to blame cholesterol for cardiovascular disease is shaky anyway. Health claims are commercial inspired. And they change from one subject to another because you can't get subsidy for it for all the time. And so the conclusion really is that you shouldn't believe too much of claims made left, right, and center. They often contradict each other and their grounds are shaky. How about research and development in edible oils and fats? A sorry state of affairs. See, the chemical industry has its own processes. And it uses companies like Fluor or Lummus or Kellogg to construct plants according to their own design. But the edible oil industry is totally relying on what engineering companies like De Smet Balestra and Crown Ironworks and so forth supply them. They are more and more MBA controlled, and technology is just unpredictable. They don't want to have anything to do with it. And so innovation emerges from engineering companies and suppliers of auxiliaries, but they supply something, but don't really know how it performs in practice. And the MBAs, they want a well-proven design, off-the-shelf extraction unit, must be a strong shelf. And since the existing plants are very, very big, say there is a plant in Rotterdam to deodorize palm oil with a capacity of 600,000 tons a year. Now, that is a lot. And yeah, if you come with another process that might in theory be better, you want to start it on a small scale in order to see whether it works, and you don't want to risk too much money, then it is not competitive. So they're a bit stuck in what they got. They missed the boat quite some time ago, and now it just goes on. And now comes the slide I always use at the very end, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Albert, for a very interesting presentation. I think we'll ask for some questions. While we're getting that ready, if anyone wants to ask a question, could you just raise your hand, not necessarily with a pencil in it, and we will then take your question. So let's start with questions. Maybe I could ask a very simple question at the beginning. I've never had a great deal of confidence in nutritionists. Would that summarize your situation as well?
Well, I tend to agree with you because people are so different. Yeah. I am now undergoing some cancer treatments and so forth, and I'm warned very much that, yeah, we cannot predict the side effects because they differ from one person to another. Mm-hmm. And some people are not worried by this at all, and others they are.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the same happens with food. Yeah.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Some people are allergic to strawberries, yeah, eggs. Others eat them with gusto.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then, it is too general.
Mm-hmm.
And because one time I got rid of half my colon. So the healthy diet gives me diarrhea, just like that. I need no roughage whatsoever, please.
Yeah.
It's not all nonsense. And it would be nice to know why people are getting more and more obese and see whether you can do something about it. It's a very complex matter. And I'm sure that, again, what works for one will not work for the other.
No. Questions? Looking around, do we have somebody coming up?
Mike.
Yep. Yes.
Malcolm.
Mike.
Hi. So, one of the modern fads, is a teaspoon of, say, fish oil a day. Do you think these really have any value?
Did you hear that, Robert?
Sorry, I didn't quite hear it. Two spoons of what?
No, a teaspoon. One teaspoon of fish oil a day.
Fish oil a day.
Fish oil.
Yeah, is meant to be good for you. Is this just marketing or is it really one teaspoon that's any good?
Well, I prefer the fish anyway. Obviously, I'm a Dutchman, so the herring season is almost there, yeah? Work has been done, and the original findings were encouraging for fish oil. But then it turns out that it is really beneficial for people who suffer from lack of certain enzyme activity. Mm-hmm. Fish oil has the last double bond, three atoms away from the terminal methyl group in the fatty acids. Yeah. When you change fatty acids biochemically, you grow it, you desaturate it, the last double bond stays where it is. So that is the omega-6 and omega-3 story. And just to give you an example, that you see big advertisements. Now our health margarine has also omega-3 fatty acids in it. Mm-hmm. And the conclusion is simple. They have replaced expensive sunflower seed oil by a bit of soybean oil that is much cheaper. Now, there are many people, who have difficulty in modifying the fatty acids they eat, which are essential. Omega-6 and omega-3 fatty acids are essential because they are precursors of prostaglandins, etc. And that is a long route. You start with 18.2, you have to go to 18.3, 23, and so forth. And then finally you have 22.6 or 25. That are many steps, and if one of these steps is a bit hesitant, then it is beneficial if you skip that step. But if you are perfectly healthy, there is no need to waste money.
Very good. Other questions? Not yet. Looking around.
David?
Yeah, please.
As a child, I was brought up on castor oil. Have you any comments?
Brought up with?
Castor oil. In the 40s, that is what we were all had to consume. It was terribly, it was an awful taste, but this is what we were given because it was regarded as being healthy.
Well, it's a lubricant, it is not absorbed. I was fed cod liver oil as cod a liver. Child. Perhaps many of you heard that also tastes foul, but that was for its vitamin content. Not so much for the triglycerides in it. It's a strong, rich source of vitamin D and A. And after the war, people really needed this. But castor oil, as far as I can think, is only good as a lubricant. And in Canada, they're called an oil Harlem. Only, I don't know whether it is paraffin or castor oil, but it may be an act against constipation, I don't know.
A good explanation.
Okay. Thank you, Albert.
Thanks, David. Do we have other questions? You mentioned your margarine with a high polyunsaturated fatty acid content.
Yes.
That intrigued me. Did that ever get anywhere?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. It has been pushed left, right, and center. It was called B-cell, yeah?
Okay, right.
B-cell is blood cholesterol lowering.
Okay.
Now, that is not allowed to have a name with a meaning, but there are not many people who know the name B-cell stands for blood cholesterol lowering.
Right.
And one of the first projects I rounded off at Vanaporta was a process of directed intensification.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you intrasterify triglycerides, you reshuffle
mm-hmm.
fatty acids over the backbones. And if you cool down, the highest melting triglycerides in that mixture will precipitate,
mm-hmm.
which means that what is left in the liquid is no longer at equilibrium, at random, is no longer random. So they start to make more
interesterification,
high melting.
Mm-hmm.
And that way we could convert a liquid oil in a more or less solid fat that could be used to make margarine. Well, the consistency was like snot, but never mind. and we did better than Unilever in this respect, and they didn't like this at all, and they thought we had infringed on one of their patents, and they came to the plant with a policeman for a beschrijvend beslag, write down what we were doing.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, we filed, accused them of us espionage and so forth. Wow. Yes, it was a big problem. But now you don't hear much about it anymore.
No. Do we have other questions? Looking around.
Well, allow me.
David
again? Yes.
Palm oil has acquired a very bad reputation as being not eco-friendly. Is there an obvious substitute for palm oil in food products?
Sorry, can you repeat the question, Bob? I couldn't quite hear.
The question was, is there an interesting alternative for palm oil because of its ecological implications by using increasing palm oil production, something we don't want to do? Can we find a way of replacing palm oil with something else that would be less ecologically damaging?
Well, first of all, you should make palm oil less ecologically damaging by cutting down a lot of palm trees that have low yields and replace them with high yield trees. Yeah, that will increase the production by a factor of 3. Secondly, there are lots of efforts. Say, for instance, Yatropha curcas. That is a plant that has good drought tolerance,
mm-hmm.
and so forth. And the only problem is that you can't harvest because the berries are not ready at the same time. So you need lots of little children to collect them all along. But it has a good drought tolerance, but when it does get little water, it produces little oil. Mm-hmm. So that is not a very good thing. You have algal oil.
Mm-hmm.
Algae are highly productive. But if you have a pond in which you allow the algae to grow and make a lot of fat during the day when the sun shines, yeah, they start eating it during the night. And so the production is far less than it could be in theory. So you can have artificial elimination, but that's very expensive. And see, this whole biodiesel business is one of those stupid things people can do. It is politics. Edible oil, you can mix that with mineral oil. So when I lived in France, I heated my house with fuel, which is called, which is diesel. If you mix the oil in that, the edible oil in that, it's a percentage, you used its heat content immediately. You don't have to go to a special plant and purify the biodiesel, upset the glycerol market, and so forth. But then that doesn't sell. You see, a politician wants to stand next to in a petrol station with his hand resting on the pump that supplies biodiesel, because that is what he has been achieving. He has been wasting money. You could also take all kinds of fatty material and send it to an ethylene cracker. And out comes ethylene, propylene, you name it.
Somebody there tried. Somebody tried me.
Yeah.
Yeah, I take your point. It all becomes a fad. But in fact, with a massive switch from the automobile industry towards production of electric cars, biodiesel is obviously going to be on its way out, just the way diesel is already. No. Do we have other questions? I'm looking around. No? If not, then I would like to thank you once again for a very interesting talk. Tell you that we will be able to send you a little token of our appreciation, which you should receive very shortly. And I hope that will help with your slightly sore throat.
Okay.
Thank you very much indeed, Albert. Thank you. Thank you. And thank you to all for joining us. We look forward to seeing you on the 27th of May, when we will have a lecture from Nick Lane from the University College London. And with that, thank you very much, and good evening.